Hello, I'm Russell Michaels. Thank you for joining me and welcome to Cine Politics, where we discuss the social and, of course, the political issues which have inspired all kinds of films and documentaries from all around the world. And on today's programme, we're discussing the feature film Margin Call, written and directed by J.C. Chandor. The film is set over 24 hours in the skyscraper offices of a financial industry corporation high above New York City. The economic crisis has just begun, and hundreds of staff are being fired. But one analyst has found something much worse is about to hit the company. The new financial products they've been creating are a time bomb, ready to bankrupt the entire corporation. A high-powered cast brings the hard-nosed money men to life: Kevin Spacey, Jeremy Irons, Paul Bettany, and Demi Moore as the only woman. All must battle for survival, and some must make financial and moral decisions which may save the company, but will bring ruin to many around the world.
Mr. Dale, these are extraordinary times, as you very well must know.
I don't understand.
The majority of this floor is being let go today.
Eric, I'm very sorry.
I was working on something, but they wouldn't let me finish it. So take a look at it. Be careful.
Hello?
I need you guys to come back up here.
Wait a second.
Just trust me, okay? I need you guys back here now.
Wait a minute, what am I looking at?
This figure here.
Whoa, is that?
It gets ugly in a hurry.
Is that figure right?
Sir, if those assets decreased by just 25%, that loss would be greater than the current market capitalization of this entire company.
Sell it all today.
You're selling something that you know has no value.
There are three ways to make a living in this business. Be first or cheat. You're a very important piece of this puzzle. Are you in on this?
I can't tell you that people are going to say some very nasty things about what we do here today. The ground is shifting below our feet.
Remember this day, boys. Remember this day.
So if Margin Call dramatizes the moment that Wall Street realized the financial storm was hitting, what happens next and where will it end? Well, here to discuss Margin Call are my guests: Simon Dixon, author of Bank to the Future, Protect Your Future Before Governments Go Bust, and we have Dave Calhoun, film critic for Time Out magazine. Very warm welcome to the program to both of you. To start with you, Dave, the beginning of this film is quite tense. It's a little bit like a thriller with a secret stored on a memory stick. Is it really a thriller?
It is a thriller. It's a real hothouse drama. It's set over not more than 24 hours in the offices, you know, the tower block offices in Manhattan of a bank, of a fictional bank, but one that is based on, you know, banks that we may have known through the 2008 beginning of the financial crisis. And yeah, it is a thriller from the very beginning. Someone is sacked as part of a layoff and he hands over a USB stick to another member of staff and says, you know, there's something on this here, on this USB stick you may think is interesting. And that kicks off the drama.
In some ways, I was thinking of Titanic, because it was a little bit like Stanley Tucci, who is this analyst who finds this dark, you know, a wave of disaster coming. He's a bit like the lookout on the top of the Titanic, and with the young mathematical whiz kid, sees the iceberg. Is it like that?
Yeah, it's a good analogy in the sense that we spend most of the time of this film within this tower block, actually. We even see meetings at 1 a.m, 2 a.m, 3 a.m, because things really kick off and it's a moment of intense crisis for the company. You know, we even see traders weeping in the toilets and shaving at 6 a.m, getting ready for one of the most momentous days of their lives as traders.
For battle, really. Well, Simon, to bring you in here, what aspects of this company called MBS in the film are based on the real Lehman Brothers collapse?
I'm almost certain that the film is about Lehman Brothers in their final days, when they discovered they had these toxic assets that they really needed to get rid of. And the only thing that casts that doubt in my mind is the ending of the film. It doesn't say what's next, so we're left wondering whether it could be another investment bank in that process. But I'm almost certain that the way that the film comes across, it's the early days and Lehman's was the first to really discover and make that first mover advantage, as we'd call it, to get rid of some of those assets.
And what's at stake in the film seems to be, I mean, it's mentioned as a, because you don't see the money, you see there's lots of banks of computer screens, but this $8 trillion at risk around the world from this one equation, just briefly, does that make sense as a kind of the thing that's gone wrong?
Well, in the world of mega banking, we've discovered that $8 trillion does actually make sense. These numbers which happened during the financial crisis, which have become fictitious fantasy numbers that no one can ever imagine existed, turn out to be a complete reality because the whole mortgage-backed securities, the MBS, what they call, they were all built upon taking on assets that the company was never meant to keep. That were going to be passed on to someone else, much like a hot potato.
Right, and there's one you don't want to keep for more than a few days, obviously. It's a staff call at the beginning. How does it come up? I mean, people are being let go in a kind of robotic way, and it's a familiar image now, walking out with their boxes of possessions. How does that work in the film as a kind of soulless corporate world versus the human tragedy?
Well, it's quite chilling to watch, and people may have seen Up in the Air, the film with George Clooney recently, which deals with these very faceless, chilling redundancies. But what it also brings out, I think, is it brings out some of the power play and some of the more selfish motivations of some of the employees who are left behind as well. You see somebody expressing sympathy to their boss or their colleague who's been let go, who's been made redundant, but you also see them wondering whether they're next, and you also see them looking over their shoulder to see whether someone's coming to tap them on the shoulder as well. And that definitely sets up the power games that we go on to see within the film. You know, right from the more low-level traders, still very wealthy, high-earning traders, right up to the CEO of the company, Jeremy Irons. There's a hierarchy there that where people are very well protecting their positions.
And the kind of the shark pool is getting smaller. Well, let's pause there and see a clip where executive Sam Rogers, played by Kevin Spacey, admits he's having a moral crisis about selling the company's toxic assets.
So, what can I do for you?
I want out. I'm done. I want out.
It's been a very difficult day.
I need
for
you
everyone.
To release my options. If they're worth anything after today, I want my bonus. I'm out.
You'll get your bonus, your options, and keep your current base, but I need you to stay with me for the next 24 months, okay? Oh, come on, Sam. Put a smile on your face. You did some good today. You said that yourself. Do you know, I'm starting to feel a little better about this whole thing. You're one of the luckiest guys in the world, Sam. You could have been digging ditches all these years.
That's true. And if I had, at least there'd be some holes in the ground to show for it. I just don't know how we f***ed this up quite so much.
When did you start feeling so sorry for yourself? It's unbearable. What? So you think we might have put a few people out of business today? That's all for naught. But you've been doing that every day for almost 40 years, Sam. And if this is all for naught, then so is everything out there. It's just money. It's made up. Pieces of paper with pictures on it so we don't have to kill each other just to get something to eat. It's not wrong, and it's certainly no different today than it's ever been. 1637 1697 1819 37 57 84 1901 07 29 1937 1974 1987 Jesus, didn't that fuck me up good. 92, 97, 2000, and whatever we want to call this. It's all just the same thing over and over. We can't help ourselves.
Simon, the real toxic assets that were sold, is there now a sort of a certainty or not that they were fraud, that fraud was committed because the bosses there, as you see Jeremy Irons, knows they're worthless?
Well, I remember when I was a trader on the trading floor, my job was to buy securities, my job was to sell securities. My job was not to tell the people buying securities what they were and not what the people selling them what they were as well. Is that fraud? Is that in the real world, it seems very much to be fraud if you were selling something where you don't know what it actually is. There seems to be one rule for banking and one rule for the rest of the world.
Briefly, in this film, is it kind of human failing, is greed, or just too much faith in the system?
I think there's the film does a really good job of depicting two sides to the story. What one of the great things that the senior trader talks about is how he had £2.5 million and how all of a sudden he breaks it down into nothing. That was very much a reflection of my experience of the trading floor, is that a lot of these people with vast wealth, they also have vast debts and massive liabilities every single month. And it's a bit of an illusion. Some of them are in worse positions than those on a very, you know, a 25 grand salary or so.
Well, one of the themes in this film, Dave, is that the Stanley Tucci plays a guy who used to be an engineer. He built a bridge, which people still use every day. Is it sort of questioning the value of what the money men do?
Well, we certainly see a couple of the characters in this film have a moment of crisis. I mean, in the clip there, we saw Jeremy Irons say to Kevin Spacey, you could have been digging ditches all this time. And there's a sense that Kevin Spacey is thinking, well, maybe if I'd done that, I could have been done doing something more worthwhile and less toxic than I've been doing for the past so many years and I'm about to go in and do at this moment. And yeah, and Stanley Tucci sits there in a great scene, actually, and an example of some of the film's great writing, where he sits there and remembers how in another job, he must have been working in construction, he'd been in charge of the building of a bridge, and he works out exactly how many people cross that bridge every day and how many hours they were saving by not going the long way round, etc. So he's definitely having a moment of crisis. But the other interesting thing in this film is people seem to have moments of crisis and then they're sucked back in when they're offered a couple of million dollars to put that crisis off for a couple of days.
Well, Simon, you had a crisis, you quit. Can you kind of briefly tell us what decided you?
Yeah, I had that exact moment on the stairs where I realised one day, what am I doing here? What value am I actually creating here? Every day I was taking my chunk out of the market, but I never saw what was on the other side of those numbers. I never saw the business that was being created behind those numbers.
But briefly, was it an ethical problem you were having with the kind of the culture of the job?
For me, it was more of what kind of value am I creating here? I don't see anything being created out of this. Is this just, you know, what are we doing here?
You compared it to a Ponzi scheme, which Bernie Madoff was arrested and is now in prison for. I mean, did you feel you were part of something like that?
Well, that's the thing. I don't think, and what is done really well in the film, there's a great scene when the senior trader is talking to the junior trader, and they're talking about, we just created what people wanted to buy. People wanted to borrow money to buy all their stuff, and we created a product so they could buy all their stuff.
Okay, well, it's complicated. We'll have to pause there and see a clip where Peter, the mathematical whiz kid, explains the scale of the problem to his company chairman, the slightly sinister Mr. Tulled.
Now the problem, which is, I guess, why we are here tonight, is that it takes us, the firm, about a month to layer these products correctly, thereby posing a challenge from a risk management standpoint.
And Mr. Tulled, that challenge is?
Well, we have to hold these assets on our books longer than we might ideally like to.
Yes.
But the key factor here is these are essentially just mortgages, so that has allowed us to push the leverage considerably beyond what you might be willing or allowed to do in any other circumstance, thereby pushing the risk profile without raising any red flags.
Now, thank you, Mr. Allen. Sit down. What I'm guessing your report here says, and give me some rope here. What I'm guessing it says is that considering the, shall we say, bumpy road we've been on the last week or so, but the figures your brilliant co-workers up the line ahead of you have come up with don't make much sense anymore, considering what's taking place today.
Actually, not what's taking place today, but what's already taken place over the last 2 weeks.
So you're saying this has already happened?
Sort of.
Sort of. And Mr. Sullivan, what does your model say that that means for us here?
Well, that's where it becomes a projection. But,
you're speaking with me, Mr. Sullivan.
Well, sir, if those assets decrease by just 25% and remain on our books, that loss would be greater than the current market capitalization of this entire company.
So, what you're telling me is that the music is about to stop, And we're going to be left holding the biggest bag of odorous excrement ever assembled in the history of capitalism.
Now, Dave, they have to get rid of these hot potatoes. How do we, as viewers, take this moment where, I mean, we're invested in the characters, we want to see them not come to too much harm because we like some of these guys, but how do we feel about these assets, toxic assets, being sold?
Well, we feel in on the game in some ways, I think. I mean, that meeting we just saw there is in the middle of the night. You know, and it's at 2-3 in the morning, and they're going into this day when all the traders are told to sell off these toxic assets as quickly as they can, and obviously not to tell the person on the other end of the phone what they're selling or, you know, exactly what they are. And we hear one end of the conversation, our end of the conversation, some of the traders we've met, some we haven't. And, you know, we see the clock ticking, and we know that potentially, in fact, with hindsight, we know that a global financial crisis is being stoked, exacerbated, and kicked off as well. So we kind of feel in on the trick in a way. And one of the clever things about this film is that we all like to run along with villains in some sense. And I've got to admit, it is fairly enjoyable spending time in this office and spending time with these creatures who are very well moneyed, well suited, and work on the top of the tableau with a fantastic view of Manhattan.
Well, Simon, do you agree with that? And what about the accountability? In the real world, has anybody really gone to jail for the fraud of selling something that they shouldn't have sold?
Well, the thing with banking is it's filled with conflicts of interest. What's right for one division is wrong for another division. What's right for one company is right for another company. You know, we're in this zero-sum game where people are essentially just passing on.
But isn't the SEC, the Securities and Exchange Commission, is supposed to kind of oversee this and make sure rules are not broken? Have they been, you know, lax on the job? There are accusations that they've just not investigated people on purpose.
I think it's more of an impossible job. I never, ever on the trading floor ever saw a deal go through where a takeover bid was about to happen and there wasn't a vast amount of insider trading before it.
Okay. Do you think that the anger is part of this story as well, the public anger? Where does that fit in? Are bankers just doing their jobs and feeling like they're being demonized?
Well, there's been really bad things. Bankers have done really bad things. I'm not standing up for them, but I can tell you my experience. I was an investment banker. My job was to sell deals. I'd come in sometimes up to 100 hours a week in order to do my job. I had no idea what the effect on the economy was. I didn't even really know what the economy was. My job was to do deals.
Briefly, Dave, Demi Moore is the only woman in this. She came across like having to be a man. I mean, how does she seem to you as an unusual character?
She's very good. Yeah, she plays one of the higher executives in the film. You're right, it's a very male-dominated film. And that way it reminded me of Glengarry Glen Ross, which was about a play which then became a film, which was about an estate agency. Kevin Spacey was in that, all male, all backbiting, everyone fighting for the prize as well. And it does stress that this is an incredibly male world. Apart from Demi Moore, there's only one other significant female character, which is one of the characters' wives, who we see at the very end when we get a glimpse of his personal life, Kevin Spacey's personal life. But apart from that, it's very much in the office, men together, and a very macho culture.
Well, let's pause there and see our last clip, where the company's risk assessment officers, one played by Demi Moore and the other by Simon Baker, square up for a battle for survival.
Remember this day, boys. Remember this day.
So what's the strategy here?
Well, that's where I'm headed right now, downstairs to work on it with my guys.
No, you and I with John.
I'm not sure that we need one, Sarah. That's not the way I do things.
Please.
Listen, he knows where we've stood on this. All along.
That's exactly my point. And knowing what was discussed by both you and I don't see how this could provide you with anything other than a false sense of comfort.
I'm not looking for a sense of comfort here, Sarah. I don't think there's one to be found.
Hey,
So again, what's the strategy here?
Well, I'm just not sure there's much more to do on this.
It's very simple. Don't even think about f***ing me on this. Because if we're going down, then you damn well know it'll be together.
No. I'm not sure that I do know that.
Now, Simon, you have some predictions that say we're all going down a little bit further than we have already. 2013, why is that an important date?
Well, I've been very vocal about what I think is happening next. And I think the fate that the board had in this film is the fate for a lot of the banks. And they're going to be experiencing more of that in 2012. Governments as well. And it's going to get a lot worse through 2013. Because we're doing nothing to solve the problem. There's all these assets are still out there. And we're going to have a progressive depression, I think, right up until 2017.
And you're predicting a credit card crisis and another housing crash.
We've done nothing to solve. All we've done is refinance debt. We're solving debt with more debt, and that's never going to work.
Well, Dave, what about, I mean, this seems to have a bad prognosis for the ordinary people. The ordinary people in this film is sort of symbolized by that cleaning lady in the lift, which I thought was a stroke of genius. What are they, the unseen losers?
Yeah, it's largely up to us to bring the wider world to the film. You know, we live in that wider world, so we are it, we know it. But there are a couple of points. One, yes, the cleaning lady in the lift, we're looking at her thinking she is, you know, quote unquote, one of the ordinary people who's going to be affected by what's going on in this building. And we also wonder what the hell she's thinking about these people having this high-powered conversation at 5 in the morning in the lift as well. And there's another moment as well where two of the younger traders are in the back of a car and they're looking out and saying, all these people here on the street, none of them know what's going on, none of them know how they're being affected by what we're up to. And that's very powerful as well.
They've kind of like, they're cursed with prescience of what the wave that's about to hit. But Simon, is banking reform going to happen? Are governments really going to be forced to regulate the banks, or will the banks continue to get away with it?
The banks will continue to get away with a lot more. The fact is that there's a partnership between governments and banks, and that partnership is causing a lot of trouble right now. But we're going to have to see some kind of reform, because the only way we're going to get out of that 2017 recovery is going to be by changing the rules of money and banking significantly.
It seems like the system now is like gamblers at a table in Las Vegas, and often what they do when they panic is they put more on and they risk more.
Yeah.
What's the cure?
Well, it's not more debt or more debt. We need to change the way that money is actually created is one of our big cures. At the moment, money is debt. And we need to change that, and we need to change those rules.
If we don't do that, do you think there'll be, very briefly, you know, 25 years' time, it's all going to collapse again?
25 years, I wouldn't give it that much. I'd give it till, you got till 2013, I think, to change the rules significantly.
And if we don't, briefly?
If we don't, you're going to have a significant collapse. And this is going to affect, you know, a lot worse than what we've actually seen so far.
Wow, they're stark words. Well, thank you very much for that. That's all I have time for. It's a warm thank you to my guests, Simon Dixon and Dave Calhoun. And also, thank you. And please do join us again at the same time next week. But in the meantime, we'd love to hear your views too. So please do email us at the address on the screen, cinepolitics@presstv.co.uk. And also, why not click on our Facebook fan page and join the debate there with your questions or suggestions for future films to discuss. But for now, goodbye.